Get ready for the next battle! They have come back, and with a vengeance. It's the Versus Reviews. This time we will determine my favorite version of the Aladdin video game, the Super Nintendo or the Mega Drive version? Arachne is the name, judging my game, and I say, let the hostilities begin! In a very special twist of the events, I'll be talking about the story in a lateral manner. It's the one from the Disney picture, so how do you go about it? Simple, by telling you who told it better. Since this is not a serious game, that means who had the more fun with the setting. And for a stupid level, this goes to Capcom, aka the Super Nintendo version. Because you get to play the A Whole New World scene from the movie. There's no enemies, no obstacles, just a bonus level like that. Also, there's more interactions in the levels, while all the story exposition is relegated on static scenes and text on the Mega Drive version made by Virgin Interactive. Basically, Capcom made more use of the fact that it's a video game. Now for the meat of this confrontation. The gameplay. Both titles offer two ways for you to defeat enemies. Both will give you the possibility to collect and throw apples to deal with them. It's a pretty simple concept, but it works pretty much the same since in both games you will launch them in a descending arc. But that's a secondary attack. It might be the trick to defeat some bosses, but that's more useful on the Genesis. Meaning that the big baddies are more varied in that version. Your primary one on Nintendo's console is the classic jump. They try to play on Aladdin's acrobatic abilities, but it doesn't get much varied. You'll have always only types of platforms that will help you bounce off them and onto your next victim. Ground ones and hanging ones, they change the texture, but they will still work the same. Kinda disappointing, since it's the best way to get rid of ruffians with weapons. And you don't have one. Nice and fair too. Instead, on Sega's console, you get a scimitar and it's fantastic. High attack, slow, hanging from things, on the magic carpet. It's a whole lot of action and this version deserves it. Like I said, not only the bosses are varied in their attack patterns and their resistances, but you get more erratic enemies. Having a sword makes all the difference because it allows the developers to create more complicated encounters. Seriously, the final boss in both games is Jafar for the first phase and his snake version in the second one. Capcom makes him first go all electric-like, throwing pots at you and with massive slowdowns. Then the snake can be super cheesed by just jumping on his head a bunch of times. Seriously underwhelming. Virgin made him go electric too initially, but with a twist. It uses electricity to get you close to him and do damage. The static also stops the scimitar, so that's great. You get to use the apples and that's amazing because they respawn if you finish them. Perfect thinking. Then the snake is all protected by flames and throws waves of fire at you. Just the right opportunity for learning a new pattern for the apples. Now that's a final boss challenge. In the levels, there's a pretty big gap too. The Super Nintendo ones are too linear, very Nintendo-like, very basic, not bad, even somewhat exciting at times, but not indistinctive. It would be amazing on NES, but in 16-bit it's kinda all that. The Mega Drive allows for more and it gets it. The levels are not as stupid as Earthworm Jim, meaning that you get to explore more than left to right without getting lost. There's more to go around, but also it's easy to get around. Because, intelligently so, you get stopped when you can't go forward. Or you die in lava or water. Simple, know the dance, thank the wonders. Still, much more interesting than the counterpart. Where you, jump on poles and then do it again. Maybe even grab on something if you're feeling fancy. Yeah, no contest. Both have some collectibles. They are gems for both of them, but they are only useful on the Mega Drive game. You can search for a vendor in the levels that will exchange lives and wishes for them. And if you get all the gems in the Super Nintendo game, you get a different set of credits. But I prefer the ones when you don't. They look better to me? What can I tell you? The black borders on the side are not appealing. Also, you get an extra image of Agrabah and you get told that you are a super player. Wow, what a revolutionary concept. I might donate blood to Capcom employees now. Too much? Oh well, art style wise, as per usual, when they take great care and on par with development resources, the Genesis resolves to be much better. The colors are vibrant and the variety in locations is far greater. When you play the Super Nintendo version, you get 3 different levels in a row before the next change, and they all look pretty much the same. I made fun of similarly looking levels when talking about Super Mario World. I wouldn't do anything different now. No preference here on this channel. All developers are the same. And musically is where I really got surprised. I expected Capcom to hit an easy home run, but instead they did just a simple job. Most tunes don't even reach the 1 minute mark, and that's with them looping at least once. That's really repetitive and tedious. It's especially disappointing since there's some longer tunes and they are very good. Instead, they spend time doing all those little tunes for every occasion, but quasi non-memorable moment occurs with them. On the other side of the road, the situation is quite different indeed. While you get full reinterpretations of the various pieces from a guy who thinks the Intellivision is something you can invest money in after 2020. But him and Don Griffin give it the full treatment, and they are good musicians and video game composers. At least they know how to use the sound chip of the Sega Genesis. I mean, all of them. Let's get to the endgame now. Aladdin on the Super Nintendo is a safe game, plenty enjoyable, but I would understand if you forgot about it. A 7 out of 10 for it seems like it fits the case. The Mega Drive version is much less derivative, to the point where you get surprised by the liberties that they took with the source material, in a good way. So that one gets an 8.5 out of 10, certainly a highly playable title. It doesn't get a better vote only because I wanted more levels based on tiny little scenes. The desert and the genie slump are nice, but they are not enough. If you wanna see me play the games that I will review plus some extra stuff, catch me on Twitch at ArachneRetro. Same name that I use on Twitter, where I will keep you updated with everything I am doing and more. See ya at the next review. Bye bye!